Jared Diamond, Why Is Sex Fun? Full Version, Part 04. All these features make the human species a leading candidate for male lactation. While that candidacy may take millions of years to perfect through natural selection, we have it in our power to short-circuit that evolutionary process by technology. Some combination of manual nipple stimulation and hormone injections may soon develop the latent potential of the expectant father, his confidence in paternity buttressed by DNA testing, to make milk, without the need to await genetic changes. The potential advantages of male lactation are numerous. It would promote a type of emotional bonding of father to the child now available only to women. Many men, in fact, are jealous of the special bond arising from breastfeeding, whose traditional restriction on mothers makes men feel excluded. Today, many or most mothers in first world societies have already become unavailable for breastfeeding, whether because of jobs, illness, or lactational failure. Yet not only parents but also babies derive many benefits from breastfeeding. Breastfed babies acquire stronger immune defenses and are less susceptible to numerous diseases, including diarrhea, ear infections, early age onset diabetes, influenza, necrotizing enterocolitis, and SIDS, sudden infant death syndrome. Male lactation could provide those benefits to babies if the mother is unavailable for any reason. It must be acknowledged, however, that the obstacles to male lactation are not only physiological ones, which can evidently be overcome, but also psychological ones. Men have traditionally regarded breastfeeding as a woman's job, and the first men to breastfeed their infants will undoubtedly be ridiculed by many other men. Nevertheless, human reproduction already involves increasing use of other procedures that would have seemed ridiculous until a few decades ago, procedures such as external fertilization without intercourse, fertilization of women over the age of 50, the gestation of one woman's fetus inside another woman's womb, and survival of prematurely delivered 1 kg fetuses by high-tech incubator methods. We now know that our evolutionary commitment to female lactation is physiologically labile, it may prove psychologically labile as well. Perhaps our greatest distinction as a species is our capacity, unique among animals, to make counter-evolutionary choices. Most of us choose to renounce murder, rape, and genocide, despite their advantages as a means for transmitting our genes, and despite their widespread occurrence among other animal species and earlier human societies. Will male lactation become another such counter-revolutionary choice? Chapter 4. Wrong Time for Love: The Evolution of Recreational Sex. First scene, a dimly lit bedroom, with a handsome man lying in bed. A beautiful young woman in a nightgown runs to the bed. A diamond wedding ring flashes virtuously on her left hand, while her right hand clutches a small blue strip of paper. She bends down and kisses the man's ear. She, darling. It's exactly the right time. Next scene, same bedroom, same couple, evidently making love, but details tastefully obscured by the dim lighting. Then the camera shifts to a calendar slowly being flipped to indicate the passage of time by a graceful hand wearing the same diamond wedding ring. Next scene, the same beautiful couple, blissfully holding a clean smiling baby. He, darling. I'm so glad that OVU Stick told us when it was exactly the right time. Last frame, close-up of the same graceful hand, clutching the small blue strip of paper. The caption reads, OVU Stick. Home urine test to detect ovulation. If baboons could understand our TV ads, they'd find that one especially hilarious. Neither a male nor female baboon needs a hormonal test kit to detect the female's ovulation, the sole time when her ovary releases an egg and when she can be fertilized. Instead, the skin around the female's vagina swells and turns a bright red color visible at a distance. She also gives off a distinctive smell. In case a dumb male still misses the point, she crouches in front of him and presents her hindquarters. Most other female animals are equally aware of their own ovulation and advertise it to males with equally bold visual signals, odors, or behaviors. We consider female baboons with bright red hindquarters bizarre. In fact, we humans are the ones whose scarcely detectable ovulations make us members of a small minority in the animal world. Men have no reliable means of detecting when their partners can be fertilized, nor did women in traditional societies. I grant that many women experience headaches or other sensations around the midpoint of a menstrual cycle. However, they wouldn't know that these are signs of ovulation if they hadn't been told so by scientists, and even scientists didn't figure that out until around 1930. Similarly, women can be taught to detect ovulation by monitoring their body temperature or mucus, but that's very different from the instinctive knowledge possessed by female animals. If we too had such instinctive knowledge, manufacturers of ovulation test kits and contraceptives wouldn't be doing such a booming business. We're also bizarre in our nearly continuous practice of sex, a behavior that is a direct consequence of our concealed ovulations. Most other animal species confine sex to a brief estrus period around the advertised time of ovulation. The noun estrus and adjective estrus are derived from the Greek word for gadfly, an insect that pursues cattle and drives them into a frenzy. At estrus, a female baboon emerges from a month of sexual abstinence to copulate up to 100 times, while a female Barbary macaque does it on the average every 17 minutes, distributing her favors at least once to every adult male in her troop. Monogamous gibbon couples go several years without sex until the female weans her most recent infant and come into estrus again. The gibbons relapse once more into abstinence as soon as the female becomes pregnant. We humans, though, practice sex on any day of the estrus cycle. Women solicit it on any day, and men perform without being choosy about whether their partner is fertile or ovulating. After decades of scientific inquiry, it isn't even certain at what stage in the cycle a woman is most interested in men's sexual advances, if indeed her interest shows any cyclical variation. Hence, most human copulations involve women who are unable to conceive at that moment. Not only do we have sex at the wrong time of the cycle, but we continue to have sex during pregnancy and after menopause when we know for sure that fertilization is impossible. Many of my New Guinea friends feel obliged to have regular sex right up to the end of pregnancy because they believe that repeated infusions of semen furnish the material to build the fetus's body. Human sex does seem a monumental waste of effort from a biological point of view, if one follows Catholic dogma in equating sex's biological function with fertilization. Why don't women give clear ovulatory signals, like most other female animals, so that we can restrict sex to moments when it could do us some good? This chapter seeks to understand the evolution of concealed ovulation, nearly constant female sexual receptivity, and recreational sex, a trinity of bizarre reproductive behaviors that is central to human sexuality. By now, you may have decided that I'm the prime example of an ivory tower scientist searching unnecessarily for problems to explain. I can hear several billion of the world's people protesting, "There's no problem to explain, except why Jared Diamond is such an idiot. You don't understand why we have sex all the time? Because it's fun, of course." Unfortunately, that answer doesn't satisfy scientists. While animals are engaged in sex, they too look as if they're having fun, to judge by their intense involvement. Marsupial mice even seem to be having lots more fun than we do, if the duration of their copulations, up to 12 hours, is any indication. Then why do most animals consider sex fun only when the female can be fertilized? Behavior evolves through natural selection, just as anatomy does. Hence, if sex is enjoyable, natural selection must have been responsible for that outcome. Yes, sex is fun for dogs too, but only at the right time. Dogs, like most other animals, have evolved the good sense to enjoy sex when it can do some good. Natural selection favors those individuals whose behavior lets them pass their genes to the most babies. How does it help you make more babies if you are crazy enough to enjoy sex at a time when you couldn't possibly make a baby? A simple example illustrating the goal-directed nature of sexual activity in most animal species is provided by pied flycatchers, the bird species I discussed in Chapter 2. Normally, a female pied flycatcher solicits copulation only when her eggs are ready to be fertilized, a few days before laying. Once she begins egg laying, her interest in sex vanishes, and she resists propositions from males or behaves indifferently toward them. but in an experiment in which a team of ornithologists made 20 female pied flycatchers into widows after completion of egg laying by removing their mates, 6 of the 20 experimental widows were seen to solicit copulation from new males within 2 days, 3 were seen actually to copulate, and more may have done so unobserved. Evidently, the females were attempting to trick the males into believing them to be fertile and available. When the eggs eventually hatched, the males would have no way of realizing that some other male had actually fathered the clutches. In at least a few cases, the trick worked, and the males proceeded to feed the hatchlings as a biological father would have. There was thus not the slightest indication that any of the females was a merry widow, pursuing sex for mere pleasure. Since we humans are exceptional in our concealed ovulation, unceasing receptivity, and recreational sex, it can only be because we evolved to be that way. It's especially paradoxical that in Homo sapiens, the species unique in its self-consciousness, females should be unconscious of their own ovulation when female animals as dumb as cows are aware of it. Something special was required to conceal ovulation from a female as smart and aware as a woman. As we'll discover, it has proven unexpectedly difficult for scientists to figure out what that special something was. There's a simple reason why most other animals are sensibly stingy about the copulatory effort. Sex is costly in energy, time, and risk of injury or death. Let me count the reasons why you should not love your beloved unnecessarily. 1. Sperm production is sufficiently costly for males that worms with a mutation that reduces sperm production live longer than normal worms. 2. Sex takes time that could otherwise be devoted to finding food. 3. Couples locked in embrace risk being surprised and killed by a predator or enemy. 4. Older individuals may succumb to the strain of sex. France's Emperor Napoleon III suffered a stroke while engaged in the act, and Nelson Rockefeller died during sex. 5. Fights between male animals competing for an estrus female often result in serious injury to the female as well as to the males. 6. Being caught at extramarital sex is risky for many animal species, including, most notoriously, humans. Thus, we would reap a big advantage by being as sexually efficient as other animals. What compensating advantage do we get from our apparent inefficiency? Scientific speculation tends to center on another of our unusual features. The helpless condition of human infants makes lots of parental care necessary for many years. The young of most mammals start to get their own food as soon as they're weaned, they become fully independent soon afterward. Hence, most female mammals can and do rear their young with no assistance from the father, whom the mother sees only to copulate. For humans, though, most food is acquired by complex technologies far beyond the dexterity or mental ability of a toddler. As a result, our children have to have food brought to them for at least a decade after weaning, and that job is much easier for two parents than for one. Even today, it's hard for the single human mother to rear kids unassisted, and it used to be much harder in prehistoric days when we were hunter-gatherers. Now consider the dilemma facing an ovulating cave woman who has just been fertilized. In any other mammal species, the male who did it would promptly go off in search of another ovulating female to fertilize. For the cavewoman, though, the male's departure would expose her eventual child to the likelihood of starvation or murder. What can she do to keep that man? Her brilliant solution remains sexually receptive even after ovulating. Keep him satisfied by copulating whenever he wants. In that way, he'll hang around, have no need to look for new sex partners, and will even share his daily hunting bag of the moat. Recreational sex is thus supposed to function as the glue holding a human couple together while they cooperate in rearing their helpless baby. That, in essence, is the theory formally accepted by anthropologists, and it seemed to have much to recommend it. However, as we have learned more about animal behavior, we have come to realize that this sex to promote family values theory leaves many questions unanswered. Chimpanzees and especially bonobos have sex even more often than we do, as much as several times daily, yet they are promiscuous and have no pair bond to maintain. Conversely, one can point to males of numerous mammal species that require no such sexual bribes to induce them to remain with their mate and offspring. Gibbons, which actually often live as monogamous couples, go years without sex. You can watch outside your window how male songbirds cooperate assiduously with their mates in feeding the nestlings, although sex ceased after fertilization. Even male gorillas with a harem of several females got only a few sexual opportunities each year, their mates are usually nursing or out of estrus. Why do women have to offer the sop of constant sex, when these other females don't? There's a crucial difference between our human couples and those abstinent couples of other animal species. Gibbons, most songbirds, and gorillas live dispersed over the landscape, with each couple or harem occupying its separate territory. That pattern provides a few encounters with potential extramarital sex partners. Perhaps the most distinctive feature of traditional human society is that mated couples live within large groups of other couples with whom they have to cooperate economically. To find an animal with parallel living arrangements, one has to go far beyond our mammalian relatives to densely packed colonies of nesting seabirds. Even seabird couples, though, aren't as dependent on each other economically as we are. The human sexual dilemma, then, is that a father and mother must work together for years to rear their helpless children, despite being frequently tempted by other fertile adults nearby. The specter of marital disruption by extramarital sex, with its potentially disastrous consequences for parental cooperation in child-rearing, is pervasive in human societies. Somehow, we evolved concealed ovulation and constant receptivity to make possible our unique combination of marriage, co-parenting, and adulterous temptation. How does it all fit together? Scientists' belated appreciation of these paradoxes has spawned an avalanche of competing theories, each of which tends to reflect the gender of its author. For instance, there's the prostitution theory proposed by a male scientist: women evolved to trade sexual favors for donations of meat from male hunters. There's also a male scientist's better genes through cuckoldry theory, which reasons that a cavewoman with the misfortune to have been married off by her clan to an ineffectual husband could use her constant receptivity to attract and be extramaritally impregnated by a neighboring caveman with superior genes. Then again, there's the anti-contraceptive theory proposed by a woman scientist, who was well aware that childbirth is uniquely painful and dangerous in the human species because of the large size of the newborn human infant relative to its mother as compared to that ratio in our ape relatives. A 100-pound woman typically gives birth to a 6-pound infant, while a female gorilla twice that size, 200 pounds, gives birth to an infant only half as large, 3 pounds. As a result, human mothers often died in childbirth before the advent of modern medical care, and women are still attended at birth by helpers, obstetricians and nurses in modern first world societies, midwives or older women in traditional societies, whereas female gorillas give birth unattended and have never been recorded as dying in childbirth. Hence, according to the anti-contraceptive theory, cave women aware of the pain and danger of childbirth, and also aware of their day of ovulation, misused that knowledge to avoid sex then. Such women failed to pass on their genes, leaving the world populated by women ignorant of their time of ovulation and thus unable to avoid having sex while fertile. From this plethora of hypotheses to explain concealed ovulation, two, which I shall refer to as the daddy at home theory and the many fathers theory, have survived as most plausible. Interestingly, the two hypotheses are virtually opposite. The daddy at home theory posits that concealed ovulation evolved to promote monogamy, to force the man to stay home, and thus to bolster his certainty about his paternity of his wife's children. The many fathers theory instead posits that concealed ovulation evolved to give the woman access to many sex partners and thus to leave many men uncertain as to whether they sired her children. Take first the daddy at home theory, developed by the biologists Richard Alexander and Catherine Noonan of the University of Michigan. To understand the theory, imagine what married life would be like if women did advertise their ovulations, like female baboons with bright red derrières. A husband would infallibly recognize, from the color of his wife's derriere, the day on which she was ovulating. On that day he would stay home and assiduously make love in order to fertilize her and pass on his genes. On all other days, he would realize from his wife's pallid derriere that lovemaking with her was useless. He would instead wander off in search of other, unguarded, red-hued ladies so that he could fertilize them too and pass on even more of his genes. He'd feel secure in leaving his wife at home then because he'd know that she wasn't sexually receptive to men and couldn't be fertilized anyway. That's what male geese, seagulls, and pied flycatchers actually do. For humans, the results of those marriages with advertised ovulations would be awful. Fathers would rarely be at home, mothers would be unable to rear kids unassisted, and babies would die in droves. That would be bad for both mothers and fathers because neither would succeed in propagating their genes. Now let's picture the reverse scenario, in which a husband has no clue to his wife's fertile days. He then has to stay at home and make love with her on as many days of the month as possible if he wants to have much chance of fertilizing her. Another motive for him to stay at home is to guard her constantly against other men since she might prove to be fertile on any day that he is away. If the philandering husband has the bad luck to be in bed with another woman on the night when his wife happens to be ovulating, some other man might be in the philanderer's bed fertilizing his wife, while the philanderer himself is wasting his adulterous sperm on another woman unlikely to be ovulating then anyway. Under this reverse scenario, a man has less reason to wonder, since he can't identify which of his neighbor's wives are fertile. The heartwarming outcome, fathers hang around and share baby care, with the result that babies survive. That's good for mothers as well as fathers, both of whom now succeed in transmitting their genes. In effect, Alexander and Noonan argue that the peculiar physiology of the human female forces husbands to stay at home, at least, more than they would otherwise. The woman gains by recruiting an active co-parent. But the man also gains, provided that he cooperates and plays by the rules of his wife's body. By staying home, he acquires confidence that the child whom he is helping to rear really does carry his genes. He needn't be fearful that, while he is off hunting, his wife, like a female baboon, may start flashing a bright red derriere as an advertisement for her imminent ovulation, thereby attracting swarms of suitors and publicly mating with every man around. Men accept these ground rules to such a degree that they continue to have sex with their wives during pregnancy and after menopause when even men know that fertilization is impossible. Thus, in Alexander and Noonan's view, women's concealed ovulation and constant receptivity evolved in order to promote monogamy, paternal care, and fathers' confidence in their paternity. Competing with this view is the many fathers theory developed by the anthropologist Sarah Hardy of the University of California at Davis. Anthropologists have long recognized that infanticide used to be common in many traditional human societies, although modern states now have laws against it. Until recent field studies by Hardy and others, though, zoologists had no appreciation for how often infanticide occurs among animals as well. The species in which it has been documented now include our closest animal relatives, chimpanzees, and gorillas, in addition to a wide range of other species from lions to African hunting dogs. Infanticide is especially likely to be committed by adult males against infants of females with whom they have never copulated, for example, when intruding males try to supplant resident males and acquire their harem of females. The usurper thus knows that the infants killed are not his own. Naturally, infanticide horrifies us and makes us ask why animals, and formerly humans, do it so often. On reflection, one can see that the murderer gains a grisly genetic advantage. A female is unlikely to ovulate as long as she is nursing an infant. But a murderous intruder is genetically unrelated to the infants of a troop that he has just taken over. By killing such an infant, he terminates its mother's lactation and stimulates her to resume estrous cycles. In many or most cases of animal infanticide and takeovers, the murderer proceeds to fertilize the bereaved mother, who bears an infant carrying the murderer's own genes. As a major cause of infant death, infanticide is a serious evolutionary problem for animal mothers, who thereby lose their genetic investment in murdered offspring. For instance, a typical female gorilla over the course of her lifetime loses at least one of her offspring to infanticidal intruding male gorillas attempting to take over the harem to which she belongs. Indeed, over one-third of all infant gorilla deaths are due to infanticide. If a female has only a brief, conspicuously advertised estrus, a dominant male can easily monopolize her during that time. All other males consequently know that the resulting infant was sired by their rival, and they have no compunctions about killing the infant. Suppose, though, that the female has concealed ovulation and constant sexual receptivity. She can exploit those advantages to copulate with many males, even if she has to do it sneakily when her consort isn't looking. While no male can then be confident of his paternity, many males recognize that they might have sired the mother's eventual infant. If such a male later succeeds in driving out the mother's consort and taking her over, he avoids killing her infant because it could be his own. He might even help the infant with protection and other forms of paternal care. The mother's concealed ovulation will also serve to decrease fighting between adult males within her troop because any single copulation is unlikely to result in conception and hence is no longer worth fighting over. As an example of how widely females may thus use concealed ovulation to confuse paternity, consider the African monkeys called vervets, familiar to anyone who has visited an East African game park. Vervets live in troops consisting of up to 7 adult males and 10 adult females. Since female vervets give no anatomical or behavioral signs of ovulation, the biologist Sandy Andelman sought out an acacia tree with a troop of vervets, stood under the tree, held up a funnel and bottle, collected urine when a female relieved herself and analyzed the urine for hormonal signs of ovulation. Andelman also kept track of copulations. It turned out that females started to copulate long before they ovulated, continued long after they ovulated, and did not reach their peak sexual receptivity until the first half of pregnancy. At that time, the female's belly was not yet visibly bulging, and the deceived males had no idea that they were utterly wasting their efforts. Females finally ceased copulating during the latter half of pregnancy, when the males could no longer be deceived. That still left most males in the troop ample time to have sex with most of the troop's females. 1/3 of the males were able to copulate with every single female. Thus, through concealed ovulation, female vervets ensured the benevolent neutrality of almost all of the potentially murderous males in their immediate neighborhood. In short, Hardy considers concealed ovulation an evolutionary adaptation by females to minimize the big threat to their offspring's survival posed by adult males. Whereas Alexander and Noonan's view concealed ovulation as clarifying paternity and reinforcing monogamy, Hardy sees it as confusing paternity and effectively undoing monogamy. At this point, you may be starting to wonder about a potential complication in both the daddy-at-home theory and the many fathers theory. Why is human ovulation concealed from women as well, when all that's required by either theory is for women to conceal ovulation from men? For example, why couldn't women keep their derrières the same shade of red every day of the month to deceive men, while still remaining aware of sensations of ovulation and just faking an interest in sex with lusty men on non-ovulatory days? The answer to that objection should be obvious. It would be hard for a woman convincingly to fake sexual receptivity if she felt turned off and knew that she was currently infertile. That point applies with particular force to the daddy-at-home theory. When a woman is involved in a long-lasting monogamous relationship in which the partners come to know each other intimately, it would be hard for her to deceive her husband unless she herself was deceived as well. There is no question that the many fathers theory is plausible for those animal species and perhaps those traditional human societies in which infanticide is a big problem. But the theory seems hard to reconcile with modern human society as we know it. Yes, extramarital sex occurs, but doubts about paternity remain the exception, not the rule that drives society. Genetic tests show that at least 70%, perhaps even 95%, of American and British babies really are sired legitimately, that is, by the mother's husband. It's hardly the case that for each kid there are many men standing around radiating benevolent interest, or even showering gifts and dispensing protection, while thinking, maybe that kid's real father. It, therefore, seems unlikely that protecting kids against infanticide is what propels women's constant sexual receptivity today. Nevertheless, as we'll now see, women may have had this motivation in our distant past, and sex may have subsequently assumed a different function that now sustains it. How, then, are we to evaluate these two competing theories? Like so many other questions about human evolution, this one can't be settled in the way preferred by chemists and molecular biologists, a test tube experiment. Yes, we'd have a decisive test if there were some human population whose women we could cause to turn bright red at estrus and to remain frigid at other times, and whose men we could cause to be turned on only by bright red women. We could then see whether the result was more philandering and less paternal care, as predicted by the daddy at home theory, or less philandering and more infanticide, as predicted by the many fathers theory. Alas for science, such a test is presently impossible, and it will remain immoral even if genetic engineering ever makes it possible. But we can still resort to another powerful technique preferred by evolutionary biologists for solving such problems. It's termed the comparative method. We humans, it turns out, aren't unique in our concealment of ovulation. While it's exceptional among mammals in general, it's fairly common among higher primates, monkeys and apes, the group of mammals to which we belong. Dozens of primate species show no externally visible signs of ovulation, many others do show signs, albeit slight ones, and still, others advertise it flagrantly. The reproductive biology of each species represents the outcome of an experiment, performed by nature, on the benefits and drawbacks of concealed ovulation. By comparing primate species, we can learn which features are shared by those species with concealed ovulation but are absent from those species with advertised ovulation. That comparison throws new light on our sexual habits. It was the subject of an important study by the Swedish biologists Birgitta Sillén Tullberg and Anders Möller. Their analysis proceeded in four steps. Step 1. For as many higher primate species as possible, 68 in all, Sillén Tullberg and Möller tabulated visible signs of ovulation. Aha! You may object immediately, visible to whom? A monkey may give signals invisible to us humans but obvious to another monkey, such as odors, pheromones. For example, cattle breeders trying to perform artificial insemination on a prize dairy cow have big problems figuring out when the cow is ovulating. Bulls, though, can tell easily by the cow's smell and behavior. Yes, that problem can't be ignored, but it's more serious for cows than for higher primates. Most primates resemble us in being active by day, sleeping at night, and depending heavily on their eyes. A male rhesus monkey whose nose isn't working can still recognize an ovulating female monkey by the slight reddening around her vagina, even though her reddening is not nearly so obvious as in a female baboon. For those monkey species that we humans classify as having no visible signs of ovulation, it's often clear that the male monkeys are equally confused, because they copulate at totally inappropriate times, such as with non-estrous or pregnant females. Hence our own ratings of visible signs aren't worthless. The result of this first step of the analysis was that nearly half of the primates studied, 32 out of 68, resemble humans in lacking visible signs of ovulation. Those 32 species include vervets, marmosets, and spider monkeys, as well as one ape, the orangutan. Another 18 species, including our close relative the gorilla, exhibit slight signs. The remaining 18 species, including baboons and our close relatives the chimpanzees, advertise ovulation conspicuously. Step 2. Next, Sillén Tullberg and Möller categorized the same 68 species according to their mating system. 11 species, including marmosets, gibbons, and many human societies, turn out to be monogamous. 23 species, including other human societies, plus gorillas, have harems of females controlled by a single adult male. But the largest number of primate species, 34, including vervets, bonobos, and chimpanzees, have a promiscuous system in which females routinely associate and copulate with multiple males. Again I hear cries of aha. Why aren't humans also classified as promiscuous? Because I was careful to specify routinely. Yes, the most woman has multiple sex partners in sequence over their lifetimes, and many women are at times involved with multiple men simultaneously. However, within any given estrous cycle the norm is for a woman to be involved with a single man, but the norm for a female vervet or bonobo is to be involved with several partners. Step 3. As the next to last step, Sillén Tullberg and Möller combined steps 1 and 2 to ask, is there any tendency for more or less conspicuous ovulations to be associated with a particular mating system? based on a naive reading of our two competing theories, concealed ovulation should be a feature of monogamous species if the daddy-at-home theory is correct, but of promiscuous species, if the many-fathers theory holds. In fact, the overwhelming majority of monogamous primate species analyzed, 10 out of 11 species, proved to have concealed ovulation. Not a single monogamous primate species has boldly advertised ovulation, which instead is usually, in 14 out of 18 cases, confined to promiscuous species. That seems to be strong support for the daddy-at-home theory. However, the fit between predictions and theory is only a half fit, because the reverse correlations don't hold up at all. While most monogamous species have concealed ovulation, in turn, is no guarantee of monogamy. Out of 32 species with concealed ovulation, 22 isn't monogamous but are instead promiscuous or live in harems. Concealed ovulation include monogamous night monkeys, often monogamous humans, harem-holding langur monkeys, and promiscuous vervets. Thus, whatever caused concealed ovulation to evolve in the first place, it can be maintained thereafter under the most varied mating systems. Similarly, while most species with boldly advertised ovulations are promiscuous, promiscuity is no guarantee of advertisement. In fact, most promiscuous primates, 20 out of 34 species, either have concealed ovulation or only slight signs. Harem-holding species as well have invisible, slightly visible, or conspicuous ovulations, depending on the particular species. These complexities warn us that concealed ovulation will prove to serve different functions, according to the particular mating system with which it coexists. Step 4. To identify these changes of function, Sillen-Tullberg and Moller got the bright idea of studying the family tree of living primate species. They thereby hoped to identify the points in primate evolutionary history at which there had been evolutionary changes in ovulatory signals and mating systems. The underlying rationale is that some modern species that are very closely related to each other, hence presumably derived recently from a common ancestor, turn out to differ in the mating system or in the strength of ovulatory signals. This implies recent evolutionary changes in mating systems or signals. Here's an example of how the reasoning works. We know that humans, chimps, and gorillas are genetically about 98% identical and stem from an ancestor, the missing link, that lived as recently as 9 million years ago. Yet those three modern descendants of the missing link now exhibit all three types of ovulatory signal: concealed ovulation in humans, slight signals in gorillas, bold advertisement in chimps. Hence only one of those descendants can be like the missing link in ovulatory signals, and the other two descendants must have evolved different signals. In fact, most living species of primitive primates have slight signs of ovulation. Hence the missing link may have preserved that condition, and gorillas may have inherited it in turn from the missing link, see figure 4.1. Within the last 9 million years, though, humans must have evolved concealed ovulation, and chimps must have evolved bold advertisement. Our signals and those of chimps thus diverged in opposite directions from the cues of our mildly signaling ancestors. To us humans, the swollen derrières of ovulating chimps look like those of baboons. However, the ancestors of chimps and baboons must have evolved their eye-catching derrières quite independently, since the ancestors of baboons and of the missing link parted company around 30 million years ago. By similar reasoning, one can infer other points in the primate family tree at which ovulatory signals must have changed. It turns out that switches of signals have evolved at least 20 times. There have been at least three independent origins of bold advertisement, including the example in chimps, at least eight independent origins of concealed ovulation, including its origins in us, in orangutans, and in at least six separate groups of monkeys, and several reappearances of slight signs of ovulation, from either concealed ovulation, as in some howler monkeys, or from bold advertisement, as in many macaques. In the same way, as we've just seen for ovulatory signals, one can also identify points in the primate family tree at which mating systems must have changed. The original system for the common ancestor of all monkeys and apes was probably promiscuous mating. But if we now look at humans and our closest relatives, the chimps and gorillas, we find all three types of the mating system represented: harems in gorillas, promiscuity in chimps, and either monogamy or harems in humans, see figure 4.2. Thus, among the three descendants of the missing link of 9 million years ago, at least two must have changed their mating system. Other evidence suggests that the missing link lived in harems, so that gorillas and some human societies may just have retained that mating system. But chimps must have reinvented promiscuity, while many human societies invented monogamy. Again, we see that humans and chimps have evolved oppositely, in mating systems as in ovulatory signals.